Meeting of the Laramie City Council to order on January 17th, 2017. First item on the agenda is the Pledge of Allegiance. You'll rise, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
City Clerk, can you do roll call, please?
Gabriel.
Here.
Hanson.
Here.
Henry.
Here.
McKinney.
Here.
Shumway, absent. Schuster.
Here.
Somerville.
Here.
Pierce.
Here.
Palikas.
Here.
Here.
That is 8 present and 1 absent, Your Honor.
Thank you. The next item on our agenda is we have a public hearing on original ordinance number 1959. City Clerk, can you read the notice, please?
The City of Laramie notice of public hearing. The City Council will hold the following public hearings at 6:30 p.m. on January 17, 2017 in the City Council Chambers, Laramie City Hall, 406 Ivinson Avenue, Laramie, Wyoming, to take public comments following Z-16-05, submitted by Laramie Regional Airport Jack Skinner, requesting the rezoning of an area approximately 26.5 acres in size from AE Airport Enterprise to AV Aviation, generally located at the Laramie Regional Airport. TA-16-08, submitted by Laramie Regional Airport Jack Skinner, requesting an amendment to Chapter 15.14 of the Unified Development Code to alter the landscaping requirements for properties zoned AV. All applications, plans, and specifications relative to these matters are available for review at the City of Laramie Planning Office at 405 Grand Avenue, Laramie, Wyoming.
Thank you, City Clerk. At this time, are there any members of the public that would wish to provide testimony on this item? Seeing none, I will close that public hearing. Move on to the next item, which is a public hearing regarding original ordinance number 1960. City Clerk, can you please read the notice?
The City Council will hold the following public hearing at 6:30 p.m. on January 17, 2017 in the City Council Chambers, Laramie City Hall, 406 Ivinson Avenue, Laramie, Wyoming, to take public comments on the following. Z-16-05, submitted by Laramie Regional Airport Jack Skinner, requesting the rezoning of an area approximately 26.5 acres in size from AE Airport Enterprise to AV Aviation, generally located at the Laramie Regional Airport. TA-16-08, submitted by the Laramie Regional Airport Jack Skinner, requesting an amendment to Chapter 15.14 of the Laramie of the Unified Development Code to alter the landscaping requirements for properties zoned AV Aviation.
Thank you, City Clerk. At this time, are there any members of the public that would wish to provide comment on this item? Seeing none, I'll close that public hearing. The next item is disclosures by council members. Do we have any council members that need to disclose anything regarding? I apologize, I did skip one. Item 4C, announcements. Do we have any announcements?
Mayor and Council, one from Fire.
Thank you.
Honorable Mayor, members of Council, I just wanted to let you know that at the end of last week, we received a delivery of a Type 1 ambulance that we partnered with IMH. I don't know if you remember, but we split a State Land Investment Board grant, 50% IMH, 25% City of Laramie, 25%. So we have that in our possession. The crews will be diligently working to get that in service over the next week. We are scheduled to receive delivery of the Quint pumping apparatus this Thursday, which is in 2 days. So we'll see, weather permitting. It's in Castle Rock right now, going through checkouts at the vendor's place. Once we get that, will take us a few weeks to get our training done, get it in service, but I'll send you updates on that. So
thank you very much, Chief.
This is the one with the little ladder on it.
three-story.
Yes, this will, this, Councilor Hanson, this will be exactly like our pumping apparatus, only it'll have the addition of a 68-foot aerial on top of it also.
Thank you.
Are there any further announcements? Thank you. Now let's go to item number five, disclosures by council members. Does anybody need to make any disclosures on conflicts of interest regarding any of the items on the agenda this evening? Okay. Item number six, Vice Mayor.
Okay, I move that the following changes to the agenda be approved. We have one change this evening. We are adding an item. It's going to be number 15A. And the title is Option to Purchase Real Property Between the City of Laramie, Wyoming and the Laramie Community Foundation Incorporated, a Wyoming nonprofit corporation for the Empress Lot.
Second.
Okay. Motion and second by Councilor Henry. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. Vice Mayor?
I move that the agenda be set as changed.
Second.
Second by Councilor Hanson. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? And Vice Mayor?
I move that the consent agenda be approved and that each specific action on the consent agenda be approved as indicated.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Councilmember Hanson. City Clerk, can you do roll call, please?
Gabriel?
Yes.
Hanson?
Yes.
Henry?
Yes.
McKinney?
Yes.
Kalikas?
Yes.
Shumway, absent. Schuster?
Yes.
Pierce?
Yes.
Somerville?
Yes.
That is 8 yeses, 0 noes, and 1 absent, Your Honor.
Thank you. That motion carries. Moving on to the regular agenda, item number 10, Councilmember Kalikas.
Thank you. This is an award for a professional service agreement between the City of Laramie and Haynes Mechanical Systems for the prevention, for the preventive maintenance and service on city-owned heating, venting, and air conditioning equipment. I move that Council approve the agreement for professional services between the City of Laramie, Wyoming, and Haynes Mechanical Systems of Fort Collins, Colorado for the prevention, preventive maintenance, and service of city-owned facilities in the amount of $110,790 over the 2-year term of the agreement and authorize the mayor and city clerk to sign.
Second.
Second by Councilor Schuster. City staff.
Honorable Mayor, members of City Council, I'm Scott Stevenson, Facilities Maintenance Manager. I'm here in lieu of Todd Fieser, who's busy tonight with another matter. The city first instituted a professional services agreement for heating, venting, and air conditioning in 2006. It was done in order to ensure that necessary preventive maintenance tasks were completed in a timely manner and to keep the equipment running at peak efficiency. The current agreement expires on January 31st, so requests for qualifications were solicited in October of 2016. We had four companies respond to that, and we, at that point, appointed a selection committee. It was formed to review the submittals. Consensus was that Haynes Mechanical Systems of Fort Collins, Colorado, best fit the needs of the City of Laramie. This agreement has a term of 2 years. The cost for the preventive maintenance is $55,395 per year, which is a savings of a little over $13,000 per year over the current contract. With that, I'd take questions.
Are there any questions? Councilor Hanson?
Thank you, Your Honor. Normally, we get a sheet of the bidders, and I presume this was the lowest bid, and it's lower than the previous contract was. Is that indeed the case?
Honorable Mayor, Councilor Hanson, this was a RFQ, which for a request for qualifications is not like a hard bid.
Okay.
So we actually don't look at the pricing until we select a company. All other pricing is sent back unopened.
Okay, thank you. But it was a comparable bid in any case?
We feel like we got a very good deal for what we purchased, yes.
Good. Thank you. Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you. Any other questions? Any comments on this item from council members? Are there any members of the public that wish to comment on this item? City Clerk, can you do roll call, please?
Palikas.
Yes.
McKinney.
Yes.
Henry.
Yes.
Hanson.
Yes.
Gabriel.
Yes.
Shumway, absent. Schuster.
Yes.
Pierce.
Yes.
Somerville.
Yes.
That is 8 yeses, 0 noes, and 1 absent, Your Honor.
Thank you. That motion carries. Item number 11, Councilor Hanson.
Thank you, Your Honor. I move that council approve, no, that that the council authorize the city of Laramie to award a bid to Front Range Fire Apparatus in the amount of $142,370 for the purchase of 20 SCBA packs, cylinders, face pieces, hoses, 3 battery chargers, and 6 additional batteries, and authorize the city manager to sign.
Second by Councilmember Henry. City staff, Chief Johnson.
Honorable Mayor, members of council, a little bit of history on this project. A few years ago, we applied for a FEMA grant for replacing air packs. We weren't successful on that grant. We rewrote our grant, went back again the next year, followed up with another application. We focused on what we considered high priority replacement air packs under the FEMA grant program and seated positions in our apparatus. We felt like we could justify upgrading 20 of our air packs, and FEMA agreed. We were awarded a 90-10% match up to not to exceed $150,000. So last September, we presented that grant before the council, where you accepted that grant. We then went into a process where we have the money secured. We sort of start need to evaluate some air packs. So we had a working group of firefighters where we invited vendors in, and they brought in their product and left it with us. And the guys put them through quite a bit of tests. They averaged about 20 hours of testing. The kind of things they were testing, they tested the harness, the cylinder, valve, how it worked, all the connections, regulators, breathing systems, masks, comfortability, the alarms, the overall performance, the heads-up display systems, and then we had a scoring sheet. After we did the evaluations, we sort of really seen what fit us, built our set of specs off of that, and went to bid. When we went to bid, we had 3 vendors that did provide different types of air packs to be evaluated. When we went to bid, we had 3 vendors supply bids. One of them came in late, so it was returned without consideration. So we evaluated the 2 bids. What we had was a bid from Front Range Fire for the 142, which we're recommending, and then we had the Ellen Curtis and Sons from the 97,000. We are recommending the higher bid, and we believe we can justify that. The reasons for us recommending the higher bid is the air pack that we're recommending is very similar to what our guys are used to. The mask configuration and the second stage regulator configuration, the way it works, our guys are much more comfortable with that. I did call another department that I know uses the other air pack and asked them, because I was wondering how big of a deal is that in their department. They went from what they call an ISI Viking air pack to the Avon brand air pack. So they're very similar. What he told me, he was a division chief of operations. He said their guys that were used to that air pack, really, it was no big deal for them. That's what they're used to. That's how they function their whole career. They said they have a lot of trouble with guys coming from other departments that are used to the other style of air pack. It concerns me that we could consider the lower bid and switch over to a type that our guys just aren't comfortable in, because that's their number one defense from immediate dangerous to life and health environment that they face on a regular basis. So the fireman comfortability is quite important. Moving down in our reasons, the adjustability and the fitting of the face pieces, the one we're recommending has a lot a better fit capability. They have three different sizes of nose cups and different sizes of masks. Also, the torso is able to adjust very quickly up and down where the other one doesn't. And we've had firefighters from, I guess the extreme sizes would be from 5'1" to 6'10" that we worked with in my career. So adjustability is important, comfortable wearing those. Maintenance and service locations. The vendor that we would like to purchase from is just down in Frederick. They've done our hydro testing for many years. They have a mobile trailer with their technicians. They can come up if we need help working on things. That's not offered on the Avon. We'd have to send stuff out to Salt Lake City is probably our best bet. The number of exceptions I want to talk about, there was a few exceptions on the MSA bid. There was 50-some on the Avon bid. But we build our specifications based off of what our department needs, what the firemen, when they built their specifications, that was based off of what they preferred. So that's normal, too, that would happen. I think the biggest thing that catches my attention is the scoring. The guy spent a lot of time with the air packs. They worked with them quite a bit. They crawled, climbed, sweated, worked in them, gave them really good tests. And the scores came out for the one we're recommending scored an 88%. The one we had to send back and not consider scored a 71%. And the low bid scored a 67%. So on their scoring. And therefore, I stand before you tonight recommending the higher bid. I felt like I needed to go through a bit of history on this because it is quite a distance between the two bids. So if you have any questions, I'd be glad to answer.
Councilor Hanson.
Thank you, Your Honor. I think you need to probably do a little explaining on the budget. You have a $150,000 grant. The granting agency requires a 10% match, and I didn't understand this because I think the whole thing comes to $142,370. That excludes any match from the city, and then you have to ask FEMA what to do with $7,630. So does this mean we're getting this without a 10% match and FEMA pays the whole thing? I didn't quite understand that.
Honorable Mayor, Councilor Hanson, the total budget that we're allowed to spend is $150,000. Anything below that, we would still be required to pay 10% of any project amount up to $150,000. Uh-huh. This project has come in under the bid is coming under the project allowable cost. Therefore, we'll have $7,630 left. Our plan would be, since it's 90% grant money, 10% city match, we won't be able to ask for another air pack. We can't increase the number of packs on this because they're really tied to seated positions and replacing out-of-date packs. But we will be able to purchase spare face pieces, which what we would do with it. We would supply more face pieces to our department. We will have to call and get that approved through FEMA. We'll pull that part of that match out of our general fund, our general operation budget. So,
if I may follow up, so $142,370 is what you're purchasing, right?
That's correct.
So, and you'll have to take 10% out of that from the city budget?
$14,237.
Okay. That I didn't catch. Okay. Mm-hmm. That's what it is. Yeah, down there, city's amount. So actually, then the FEMA money is $128,133. So actually, there's more money left over. Isn't
there's $7,630 left over that we'll be requesting permission from FEMA to spend the rest of that money on the.
But on you're the, only using $128,000 of FEMA money, don't you?
No, we'll have $128,133 of FEMA, $14,237. Of City of Laramie to pay for this bid, award this bid of $142,370,000. So total project cost of $150,000 leaves $7,630 left, in which of that we would have to pay 10% or $700 roughly to purchase more air masks.
Okay, thank you.
Are there any other questions?
Still doesn't quite make sense to me, but.
Can I think I might be able to help.
Please, Vice Mayor.
So how I'm hearing it is it's almost going to be like two purchases and two type projects or two. So the first amount is going to be the $142,000 plus the $14,200 to cover the 10% that the city is going to have to kick in. Then that remaining amount of $7,000 on the total grant of 150, we're gonna do another purchase. I'm not sure if it'll come for us or not, but another purchase at a $7,000 amount, and then the city's gonna have to kick in 10% of that, roughly $700. So it's like two things, no?
Yes, you're absolutely correct, but the only thing I wanted to say is the total is $150,000 with our 10% in it.
Yes.
Not $150,000 plus the 10%. The $150,000 is total, and our 10% is in that already. So I think that's what confused him the
so
most.
So think $15,000 on the city.
We didn't get a $150,000 grant. We got $135,000.
Yeah, that we call it $150,000. It's total project cost. The city's responsible for $15,000 of that.
The FEMA grant is actually $128,000, whatever.
$130,000.
Okay. Thank you. I had it backwards.
Are there any other questions? Comments from council members? Are there any members of the public that wish to comment on this item? City Clerk, can you do roll call, please?
Hanson.
Yes.
Gabriel.
Yes.
McKinney.
Yes.
Henry.
Yes.
Polikas.
Yes.
Shumway, absent. Schuster.
Yes.
Pierce.
Yes.
Somerville.
Yes.
That's 8 yeses, 0 noes, and 1 absent, Your Honor.
Thank you. That motion carries. Item number 12, Councilmember Henry.
Yes, this is Resolution 2017-09 to appoint one member to the Civil Service Commission. I move that Council approve Resolution 2017-09 to appoint one board member to the Civil Service Commission and authorize the mayor and city clerk to sign, but I need to insert some verbiage. So. Hang on. So, may I restate the motion?
Yes, please. And I think you can insert the resolution, right? Just reads to appoint the mayor to the county, to the Civil Service Commission.
Okay.
Do we need to have the alternative?
And I do believe so. City Attorney, can you clarify whether we need to read this motion to appoint the mayor and vice mayor as the alternative?
I think that the, Your Honor, the motion is a motion to approve Resolution 2017-09, which is attached, and so I think we don't need to
put
say
any of that
more
in
than
there.
That.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, good.
Well, then, my motion is already stated.
Okay. Do we have a second?
Second.
Second by the Vice Mayor. City Attorney.
Mayor, Council, this resolution follows our discussion at the recent work session. As you know, the Civil Service Commission has three members. Each of those members has a three-year term. One member's term, Mr. Brett Williams, who served fabulously for us, His term expired on October 31st of last year. So we have to appoint, or we should appoint a third member so that we have a full complement on the Civil Service Commission. The Wyoming statutes allow this council to appoint one of its members to fill a spot on the Civil Service Commission. So this resolution is written to allow you, if you wish, to appoint the sitting mayor to that term. Not the mayor will not always sit, but the mayor will sit until 2019, October 31st, 2019. Those other two Civil Service Commission members, their terms will expire in October of this year, and then another one October of the following year. You will have a chance to appoint citizens to their expired terms. This resolution is written so that the sitting mayor sits as the third member of the City Council for this term. I wrote it in a way recognizing that mayors change or mayors may not wish to serve, and that it applies then to the sitting mayor. The duly elected mayor at any given time will be on the Civil Service Commission through October of 2019.
Are there any questions? Councilor Hanson?
Just one question. Thank you, Your Honor. When the other terms expire, we cannot, and I think that's explicit, appoint another council member. It has to be a citizen.
Mayor, councilor, that's correct.
Is that explicit in, or does it have to be stated somewhere?
Mayor, Councilor, yes. In the statute, we are entitled to appoint three people to Civil Service Commission. Only one can be from council.
Thank you.
Councilor Plikas?
The question I have is, rather than making this term specific, do we have the ability to make this an ongoing appointment? Obviously, a future council could change that if they so chose, but it would allow us perhaps to not have to go through this resolution every 3 years.
I wrote this for this position, this vacant position, and I wrote this so as not to tie the hands of a future council. But that is, I think it's more prudent to make this reappointment again in 2019 if you still want the mayor or another city council person. But that's up to you. I suppose I could try to rewrite a resolution does not make this council face this again in 2019.
Could we not make an amendment to the resolution?
You could.
For it not to be term specific?
Yes, we could. And I'm trying to figure out, Councillor, the easiest way to do this.
It is not term specific now.
See, Attorney, would you like
Would I like a moment, Your Honor?
Just be section one.
Right.
That would have to be, instead of saying for a term ending October 31st, 2019, you would just leave that part off and say, City Council declares that the mayor of Laramie City Council be appointed to the CSC, period.
Here's my, and you're right, Councilor, it would just be changing that section. My hesitation without looking at the statute is I believe we make three-year appointments. And I'd like to be careful about that. So I could review the statute, but I think we make three-year appointments to the Civil Service Commission. I'd be less comfortable saying for the vacant position and it shall renew unless the council says otherwise.
So my question is then... Oh, I'm sorry.
No, you're fine, Councilor Plikas.
My question is, in state statute, it's very specific that a member of the council or the mayor mm-hmm. can be a sitting person on this board. Mm-hmm. So in essence, I'm not certain why we have to go through an appointment process every 3 years when it... allows us to do that.
I'm going to need a moment to look at that statute because I'd like to be careful.
Councilor Schuster.
I see no problem in what he's saying, but would it, I have a question, would it automatically change? Let's say you're not the mayor next time, so it automatically move to the next person then? And then it would be the mayor or the mayor's designee, so the mayor could make anyone on council the designee too. So I see no problem with just keeping this the way it is, as long as we understand when we have our meeting in 2 years in January, we make this statement so that either the mayor says, yes, I'm accepting this position, or I'm making John Smith the person next time. So, I mean, it would work that way then, just keeping it going that way. And we wouldn't have to deal with this again then.
Why don't we do this? Why don't we take about a 5-10 minute recess and let city attorney do the research that he needs to do and come back to us with an answer? Is that satisfactory?
Yes, that's very satisfactory. I will do that. I will go, look, if you wish to move on with the rest of the meeting while I do that, someone could move to move this to the end of the agenda, or...
Councilor Plikas.
I would move that we recess this item until item 15B on our agenda.
Second.
Second by Councilmember Henry. Any discussion on that motion? Public comment on that motion? City Clerk, can you do roll call, please?
Plikas?
Yes.
McKinney?
Yes.
Henry?
Yes.
Hansen?
Yes.
Gabriel?
Yes.
Shumway absent. Schuster?
Yes.
Pierce?
No.
Somerville?
Yes.
That is 7 yeses, 1 no, and 1 absent, Your Honor.
That motion carries. We'll move that to the end of the agenda. So we are going to move on right now to item number 13, which is Councilor McKinney.
I move to amend the solid waste fund budget in the amount of $35,000 to cover the cost of additional work associated with the Stage 1 lifetime permit amendment.
Second.
Second by Councilmember Henry. City staff, Mr. Webb.
Honorable Mayor, City Council, the purpose of the amendment in front of you tonight is to cover the unbudgeted costs of installing 2 new groundwater monitoring wells and abandoning and plugging 2 others. A few months back, we started working toward a permit amendment for the Stage 1 vertical expansion for construction and demolition waste. When we started that process, we decided it would be prudent to meet with DEQ staff, let them know where we were going, get them on board, and make sure we had all our ducks in a row. At that meeting, they let us know that they wanted to see 2 new groundwater monitoring wells on the south side of the landfill where there's currently no groundwater monitoring wells before we move forward with an expansion on top of Stage 1. During the meeting, we also requested to abandon 2 existing wells that we're basically not getting any value out of at this point. To be quite honest, they probably should have been abandoned years ago. While meeting with DEQ through the project, they let us know that a portion of the groundwater monitoring well installation would be reimbursable through a groundwater monitoring grant that DEQ has in place. And so $12,711 will be, we'll pursue that to get that money back through the grant program. That's what I got. Any questions?
Are there any questions? Councilor Hansen.
Thank you, Your Honor. On that reimbursement, here in my documents it said could be. So have you applied for this grant, or has it already been approved, or where does it stand?
We will, when you approve it, we're going to start the application process with DEQ. They've asked us to start that process, and I told them I got to wait till we're even approved through council to move forward with the project. So we'll start that, And there's a lot of paperwork that goes along throughout the project, and then we submit the work plan and all the drilling reports and everything at the end of the project to get that grant money back.
But
so it's
we have a fairly good chance of getting it.
Yeah, I think so. They're the ones that directed us to do it, so there shouldn't be any problem recovering that money.
And the next question is, $12,700 or whatever is not quite 50%. This is the maximum amount that's allowable.
Yeah, it's 50% of the eligible costs, so not the entire amount is eligible.
Okay.
There's only certain things through the process that are eligible.
Thank you.
Are there any other questions on this item? Any comments by council members? Comments from the public on this item? City Clerk, can you do a roll call, please?
McKinney.
Yes.
Henry.
Yes.
Hansen.
Yes.
Gabriel.
Yes.
Polikas.
Yes.
Shumway absent. Schuster.
Yes.
Pierce.
Yes.
Somerville.
Yes.
That's 8 yeses, 0 noes, and 1 absent, Your Honor.
Thank you. That motion carries. Councilor Schuster, item 14, please.
Thank you very much. The title of Regional Ordinance Number 1959, rezoning an area approximately 26.5 acres in size from AE Airport Enterprise District to AV Aviation District, generally located at the Laramie Regional Airport. I move to approve Original Ordinance Number 1959 on second reading, rezoning an area approximately 26.5 acres in size from AE Airport Enterprise District to AV Aviation District, generally located at the Laramie Regional Airport, based on findings of facts and conclusions of law, noting a public hearing was held on January 17, 2016.
Second.
Second by Councilmember Hansen. City staff, Leonard Connor.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. As this is second reading, but we do have a few new faces here on Council, I'll give somewhat more of another in-depth reading of what exactly this project is for our new folks. So it is a rezoning request for a small portion of the airport, roughly 26 acres. Currently, it is zoned AE or Airport Enterprise, which is a normal designation for those types of businesses that are supported by the airport. So things as hotels and different type of commercial entities that, you know, may have shipping needs and things like that, so they're located close to the airport for a reason, or help accommodate business travelers, things like that. When the airport was added as part of the city and annexed, it got this zoning classification that was more or less sort of a guess on how the airport board thought the airport was going to develop and change over the years. Currently, this portion of the airport is being used for private hangars. There's no public access, and there's, I believe, an 8-foot security fence along the exterior of this portion. There is a gate as well that has coded access, so anybody that is renting or owns a hangar in that area does have access to it, but there's no accidental entry. It's part of the, as I believe they refer to it, the inside of the fence portions of the airport that not everybody's allowed to be in. So this would rezone that to the aviation zone, which is more of what we see in those closed areas, the runways, the different types of facilities that are used for the actual operation of the airport, as opposed to the different type of commercial entities that use the airport. We may see this type of thing happen in the future again as the airport continues to expand and see new uses, but this small portion would be given the designation that it's currently being used for. I will note that the next item on the agenda is a text amendment for landscaping within these AV zones. So in the future, you would see this portion of the airport being affected by the text amendment for the landscaping purposes. So I'd be happy to answer any questions, as well as the applicant is here as well, if you have any for him.
Do we have any questions for city staff? Councilor Henry?
I have a question about the Laramie Regional Airport Board. Are they okay with this, what we're doing? Do we know?
City staff.
Mayor and Council, the applicant, Mr. Skinner, is a representative of the board.
Oh, okay.
So this came directly from them.
All right, good. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
I think he's nodding.
Any other questions for city staff? Any comments on this from council?
I'll have a comment actually on the next item, but you brought it up already. The table that is attached to the next document keeps on saying NA, not applicable. And for you folks, it seems, you know, I used to do research, and the one thing I really hated was footnotes, you know, when it says go someplace else. And why not include what it needs to be in there, instead of saying at the footnote, refer to exceptions, section 1508, then I have to go to someplace else. Can you change that, include it in this table? I don't know where this belongs.
Well, Councillor Hanson, if that's an item for landscaping, can we wait till the next item?
Yeah.
To get that answered?
Fine.
Okay.
Fine. He brought it up, so.
Fair enough. Does the applicant wish to comment on the rezoning item?
Yeah.
If you could identify yourself for the record, please. Thank you.
My name is Jack Skinner, the airport manager. Honorable Mayor, members of the council. First off, Mr. Wes Bressler, a member of the airport board, is along for support. And I just wanted to thank the city staff and the planning department and the planning commission for helping us out with our zoning amendment request. This isn't only going to make the airport safer in regards to aircraft movement, but it's also going to open up an area for hangar development, which you know, is going to help the airport economically in the future. If we, you know, if we have people that want to build hangars, and now we've got a space available for them that where they don't have to meet the more strict requirements as far as landscaping and facade improvements to their hangar. As far as the zoning amendment, we appreciate your vote, and we appreciate the help that we've received from the city staff.
Thank you. Are there any other comments from the public on this item? Any other comments from council on this? City clerk, can you do roll call, please?
Schuster.
Yes.
Shumway, absent. Palikas.
Yes.
McKinney.
Yes.
Henry.
Yes.
Hanson.
Yes.
Gabriel.
Yes.
Pierce.
Yes.
Somerville.
Yes.
That's 8 yeses, 0 noes, and 1 absent, Your Honor.
Thank you. That motion carries. Councillor Schuster, item 15.
Thank you. Title is original ordinance number 1960, amending title 15 of the Laramie Municipal Code for the purpose of amending chapter 15.14 to alter the landscaping requirements for the property zone AV or aviation. I move to approve original ordinance number 1960 on second reading as recommended by the Planning Commission that will amend table 15.14.050-2- landscaping requirements and create exemptions for the AV aviation zone district within the LMC 15.08.050.A.5.H of the Unified Development Code based on findings of facts and conclusions of law.
Second
by Councillor Henry. City staff.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. Again, I'll do somewhat of an in-depth look at this for our new folks. As previously mentioned, this is a text amendment within our Unified Development Code specifically for the landscaping requirements at the aviation zone. Currently, our landscaping requirements require buffer yards as well as potentially odd landscaping to be at an airport, especially with one similar to ours where there's potentially some new development in the center that could, you know, not be similar to development in the rest of town where you have a defined perimeter of that site and that development. Currently, that's typically how landscaping is handled as well as it's calculated by the site perimeter. Currently, if there were to be a development within the airport, clearly we wouldn't calculate the entire site perimeter of the airport, but we would use the very minimum buffer yard and building envelope to calculate that amount of landscape. With this change, if you'll look at attachment A, it'll make a lot more sense. The L1, L2, L3, those are those buffer yards that I was referring to. Those refer to the different number of landscaping units that would be required per linear foot of the quote-unquote site. This change would allow the aviation zone to be calculated slightly differently. So if you note how Councilor Hansen referred to the NAs all over the table, that new row would be specifically for the aviation zone. And if you flip over to the next page, 050A.5.H.1.D, it would create an exceptions section for this AV zoning district where the landscaping units that would be required would be calculated based upon each 1,000 square foot of development area. So if a new hangar were to be coming in, we would look at that development area specifically and calculate the landscaping units required based upon how much was being developed, because there aren't really any real sites within the airport zoning district. So if you'll also notice down on D, subset 3, as opposed to the required landscaping being around the development as it currently stands, this would allow for it to be placed in another portion of the airport that would be more appropriate and in an area that we would like to see more beautification happen, such as the exterior and in those AE, those commercial enterprise areas where we want to be inviting and we want people to, you know, walk up to a place that looks good as opposed to a private hangar area. One of the reasons why we did it this way, we had two options that we recently came up when looking at this text amendment. One would be to incorporate most of it within the table, but if you notice the length and in-depth verbiage within the exceptions section, that was very difficult to be able to put into a reasonable manner within the table. In theory, we could have put 10 units per 1,000 square feet, but nowhere else on the table does it refer to the unit calculation. It only refers to buffer yards. So since there aren't any buffer yards within the AV zoning district potentially, we felt it would be easier to say we, you know, get this out of the way, and if you're specifically looking for the airport aviation zoning district, refer to the exception section because it's an entirely different ball game than the rest of the city. So there was some thought put into why we wanted to have it this way, and we did just feel that it was a lot cleaner. And if someone who didn't know the code as well as we were, they would go to the landscaping section and they'd see, okay, aviation, this refers to a different section. They can get all their information in one spot as opposed to it being in two. I'm happy to answer any questions. Again, the applicant is here if you have any for him.
Councilor Hansen, did that answer your question on the table?
Yeah, it does, but I'm not terribly happy with it this way, I must say. If you put the footnote in and put this right under the table instead of in a different section. It looks like here, it looks like it's right there, you know, but in the document, of course, it is removed. I'd rather see it right there, you know. As I say, It was always cumbersome when I worked at the university to go there and then go there, and I'm not terribly happy, but in God's name, leave it this way. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor Hansen. Are there any other questions on this item regarding the landscaping change? Councilor Henry?
What, questions or comments?
Questions.
Okay, no questions.
Nope, okay. Actually, I want to ask the applicant if they want to say anything before we take comments, if that's okay. Is there anything from the applicant on this item?
You covered it well.
Okay. Councilor Henry.
Well, comments? I'm glad that that we're willing to budge on some of this, because really, landscaping on a runway or around a hangar, I don't think is appropriate, and I like that you have the ability then to kind of trade it out for other places that might need some more beautification. So, thanks.
Any other comments from council on this item? Any other comments from the public? City Clerk, can you do a roll call, please?
Schuster.
Yes.
Gabriel.
Yes.
Hanson.
Yes.
Henry.
Yes.
McKinney.
Yes.
Palikas.
Yes.
Shumway, absent. Pierce.
Yes.
Somerville.
Yes.
That's 8 yeses, 0 noes, and 1 absent, Your Honor.
Thank you. That motion carries. Item 15A, Councillor Gabriel.
I'm excited. This is my first one. Thank you, Your Honor. I would move to approve the option to purchase real property between the City of Laramie, Wyoming, and the Laramie Community Foundation, Inc., a Wyoming nonprofit corporation, for the Empress Lot, and authorize the mayor and clerk to sign.
Second.
Second by the Vice Mayor. City staff, City Manager.
Mayor and members of council, as you noted in the pre-council discussion, this is an option agreement that would allow the current owner of the Empress Lot downtown, which is the Laramie Community Redevelopment Foundation Incorporated, to give to the City of Laramie that lot to facilitate the project, which of course you're all familiar with, that we're planning in conjunction with the Laramie Main Street Association. That project has been previously approved in an application for grant funding for the project submitted to the Wyoming Business Council. Really, this is the last sort of crossing of T's and dotting of I's in terms of contracts and documents that need to be approved by you in order to have everything in order for SLIB to approve, hopefully, finally approve on Thursday of this week, the funding for the project. So if you have any questions, let me know. You'll know it's a donation. There's a small exchange of consideration, but in truth, it's a donation of land to the city. We'll hold ownership throughout the course of the construction down there. And then according to the terms of the project development agreement you all have previously approved, Laramie Main Street will become the ultimate owner of the property, leasing the retail frontage on the main floor to Big Hollow Food Co-op, and providing tenant finishes on the second floor based on market demand for either at some point in the future apartment housing of some sort or business, just depending on what will be the highest and best use at a future date.
Thank you, City Manager. Are there any questions on that, Councillor Schuster?
Oh, mine was a comment, but I'll wait.
Okay. Any questions on this? Councillor Schuster, so comments.
Okay, thank you. Klaus and I were the only ones on here last time on council when this all happened, and I'm glad they're donating it. I don't want to sound bad or anything else, but the instructions were that when the city tore this building down, at great cost to the citizens of Laramie, is we were going to put a lien against this place. Mm-hmm. We didn't do that, so this donation of $76,000 is very nice of them, but is a drop in the bucket compared to what it cost
1.5
to remove that building and this hazardous waste inside of it. So I'm glad this is a gift in kind. It wouldn't have been as nice because this was at great cost to the city to do this. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments from council on this item?
It was projected to be more than that.
City Clerk, can you do roll call, please?
Gabriel.
Yes.
Hanson.
Yes.
Henry.
Yes.
McKinney.
Yes.
Palikas.
Yes.
Shumway, absent. Schuster.
Yes.
Pierce.
Yes.
Somerville.
Yes.
That's 8 yeses and 0 noes and 1 absent, Your Honor.
Thank you. That motion carries. City Attorney?
Do I need to reintroduce it?
I'm not quite sure yet. City Attorney, are we ready for item 15B, or would you like us to take a break?
Ready enough, Your Honor.
Okay. Councillor Hedy?
Okay, I would move to approve, or do I bring it back on the table? Do I read the same motion again to bring it on the table again?
City Attorney, what's the proper procedure to bring it back on?
I think you can make the motion again. It's short enough. That doesn't hurt.
Okay, all right.
Thank you.
So I move that council approve resolution 2017-09 to appoint one board member to the Civil Service Commission and authorize the mayor and city clerk to sign.
Second.
Second.
Second by Councilor Plikas. City Attorney.
Well, I will need your guidance. The statute is fairly brief in its wording on this topic. It says, of course, you will appoint commissioners. The mayor, with council approval, will appoint commissioners. And it says, each commissioner shall be a qualified elector of the city and serve without compensation for a term of 3 years until his successor is appointed and qualified. So I think the question before you is just what was posed by Councilor Palikas. Do you wish to have a future council consider this again in 2019, toward the end of 2019? Or should we try to craft some language right now so that this is a continuing appointment of the mayor or vice mayor?
Councilor Plikas?
I would make an amendment to take away the term limit of this motion and to make it a continuing appointment.
Second.
If I may.
Second by Councilor Schuster. Councilor Plikas?
The reason for this is very simple. I've come to the conclusion, and I think some more than myself on here have come to the conclusion that this is a very, very important board. As a matter of fact, the Supreme Court has said that, in essence, we have no right as a city to appeal any decisions of this board because it is not an independent board, but it is an attachment of the city. I think I would assume a majority of us on this council agrees that we need to have a representative on this board, and that representative should be we should even filter it out a little bit more than just any member. It should be a member of our leadership that we've voted on. And the reason why is because these decisions have tremendous ramifications for our community. Now, my concern is, as time goes on, issues get put aside, they don't become as important, and so forth and so on. I'd like us to establish the importance of this and allow other counselors or other councils to just follow suit. In the future, if a council disagrees with this, they certainly can change it and do whatever they'd like to do. But I'd like it to be continuing so that 6 years from now, councilors aren't scratching their head and wondering why this is an appointment and why we don't have a citizen on it. In other words, just make it in perpetuity, if you will. That's my reason behind it.
Councilor Henry.
So my question would be, would we have to give some actual verbiage right now? I mean, because if this is a resolution that we're voting on, don't we have to see the words, or would we be postponing this, or?
City Attorney.
Now I can't remember when the next Civil Service Commission meeting is happening. I believe it's next week.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. And so I think I would hate to wait for another regular meeting 2 weeks from now. I have suggested language that I've drafted along the lines of this amendment. If you'd like to hear it.
Yes.
Yes, please.
Yeah, I'd like to hear it.
I would recommend changing just section one, if you'll read along with me. Let me figure out what I'm saying. Okay, I don't think we change section one. We put a comma, and after expiration of this term, shall serve successive 3-year terms as a member of the CSC, period.
Councilor Plikas.
Mayor, I am perfectly comfortable of changing my motion so that the wording is as stated by our city attorney.
Okay. Does the second agree?
Yeah.
Okay. Second agrees.
If you'd like me to read it again, I'll read the whole thing again if you want it.
Make sure she has.
City clerk, please.
You're not changing anything further. Just
section one is amended to, instead of ending in a period, we will put a comma, and then we will say, and after expiration of this term, shall serve successive 3-year terms as a member of the CSC, period. And I can give it to you later.
Are there any further comments on this amendment? Councilor Hanson?
I see a small problem with this because our mayoral terms are usually two years.
Right.
Just changes.
And if I may respond, please. Mayor, Councilor Hanson, that's what Section 2 and Section 3 are meant to accomplish.
Okay.
I don't believe changes are needed there. We are saying that this appointment applies to the then duly elected mayor. The person holding the mayor's chair during the term of this appointment, which this appointment is now continuing, mm-hmm. changes, and the new duly elected mayor shall assume the position.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay.
For the remainder of the term.
Vice Mayor?
So, and we're pretty sure in statute it says 3-year terms. So the changes we're making are within statute. I mean,
if I may respond, Mayor,
please.
Mayor, Councilor Pierce. Yes.
Okay.
We have a vacancy that expires on October 31st, 2019. It's our obligation, I think, to appoint someone until then, and we are saying for that position, we are appointing the mayor, and then for every 3-year term after that. I do want to be clear. So the other two positions will come up. They'll come up in the normal course of events. Now, I do want to be clear that this does bind council, future councils, and binds you for a while. In this sense, is that there is no good procedure for council to remove a civil service commission member. The civil service commission has its own bylaws. If someone defaults in their obligations, etc., they can do that. But if you don't like your mayor being on a civil service commission, and you haven't changed this resolution, that mayor in the future will be on the civil service commission for 3 years. Mm-hmm. So recognize that. There's no way to fix that. When you appoint somebody to the civil service commission, whether it's the mayor or a citizen, you don't remove them. You can't. You have to wait for them to quit or their term to expire.
Can I ask?
Please.
So when we have folks, okay, so our current mayor is going to be mayor for 2 years.
Perhaps.
Or more, right? But at least two, whatever. Anyway, so if we get a new mayor, do we have to go through the paperwork sort of on the consent agenda? So we don't have to say that this person resigns and we have a new one. So everything with this is basically stopping all kind of resigns from the position, and then we have to put a new one in, resigns, and a new one. So it's just in perpetuity, basically.
Correct.
Okay. Okay.
Any other questions? Councilor Hanson?
Would it be just as efficient in Section 1 to add the word, the City Council declares that the mayor of the City of Laramie, City Council ex officio, is appointed?
Mayor?
City Attorney, please.
Councilor Hanson, I thought about ex officio. I thought it was... We are accomplishing essentially the same thing, but we are trying to stay within the language of the statute for three-year appointments. And we're trying to make it specific to this vacancy. Now, I'm willing to be convinced otherwise, but we are, in essence, making an ex officio appointment.
That's what I thought.
But I felt I was trying to craft it to the language of the statute for three-year terms.
Yeah.
Are there any other questions? Any comments on the amendment? Any comments from the public on the amendment? City Clerk, can you do roll call? And this is to the amendment.
Polikas.
Yes.
Shumway, absent. Schuster.
Yes.
McKinney.
Yes.
Henry.
Yes.
Hansen.
No.
Gabriel.
Yes.
Pierce.
Yes.
Somerville.
Yes.
That is 7 yeses, 1 no, and 1 absent, Your Honor.
Thank you. That motion carries. Now we're back to the main motion. Are there any other questions on the main motion? Comments on the main motion from the council members? Any comments from the public on the main motion? City Clerk, roll call on the main motion, please.
Henry.
Yes.
McKinney.
Yes.
Polikas.
Yes.
Shumway, absent. Schuster.
Yes.
Gabriel.
Yes.
Hansen.
Yes.
Pierce.
Yes.
Somerville.
Yes.
That's 8 yeses, 0 noes, and 1 absent, Your Honor.
Thank you. That motion carries. We are going to go on to item 16, consideration of future council work sessions. Does anyone have any topics that they'd like to add to the upcoming work session list?
Let's work on the ones we have.
Okay. Done? All right. Moving on to the next item, item 17, public comments on non-agenda items by sign-in request. We have no sign-in request and no public.
Is there a sheet?
Okay. Thank you.
I think she forgot her button tonight.
What makes you want to say something?
We got 30 seconds to wait.
That's teaser.
I already am.
Thank you very much. There's no public comment by sign-in request. Councillor Hansen, item number 18, please.
I move that council adjourn to executive session regarding land negotiations.
Second.
Second by the Vice Mayor. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? All right, we are adjourned to executive session.
Do the new folks know where we go? Downstairs? Yeah.